Okay, let's start our good day. Let's start our next meeting. That is a discussion on graph algorithms with proper search. So we discuss standard DFS and BFS algorithms and some problems that use dynamic programming approach on DHS. So DFS algorithm is some search for graph. Let us consider a graph with n vertices and m edges. For example, let me draw an example. We have a graph that is something like this. Sorry. Third edge, fourth edge, this one, fifth edge. They are connected. This one connected, that's enough. Okay, and we can store graph in the different ways. One of standard way is adjacency lists, list of neighbors. That means that for each vertex, we store list of their neighbors. For example, here we can store for first vertex, it is 2 and 4. For second vertex, it is 3, 5, and 1. For third vertex, it is 2 and 5. For fourth vertex, it is 1 and 5. For fifth vertex, it is 2, 3, 4. It is what we store. It is list of neighbors for each vertex. We want to invoke DFS algorithm for for a graph that's stored in this way. So let's look to the standard form of DFS algorithm, one of standard forms, okay. What we do here, we have a Boolean array that indicates that a vertex is visited or not, and when we want to visit vertex V, we marked it as a visited, and then consider all neighbors of the vertex V. And if a neighbor X is not visited, then we invoke the DFS algorithm for this vertex. So well, let us modify this part in the following way that will be. In this way. So in fact, what we do, we consider all not visited neighbors of vertex V, and our loop, this for loop, iterate by these elements. And here we can modify this part by quantum procedure that return us list of all not visited elements of list neighbors V. For example, if we have this, list for second vertex, and first element is already visited, then what we can do, what we have, the not visited, we have two not visited elements, and we should return them. So in other ways, we have some function f that is f I is one if and only if for some index I, for some index I that is index in our neighbors V, that this one list element of this list, and it is one if visited of element which index is I've this index is value that's stored in I've position of this to the neighbor's V if it is false. Yeah, if this is false, then Fi is one. It is we're interested in not visited element. So what we want to return list of all ones, all marked elements. It is exactly the problem that we considered on the previous meeting, and we can do it in quantumly. After returning these elements, we invoke DFS for all of these elements. So this is quantum version of DFS. Let's consider the complexity of this procedure. Okay, for this one, clear. So, as you remember, the complexity of the procedures that return all marked elements of list is square root of number of elements in list times number of marked elements. So LV will be the size of list of neighbors for vertex V, and NV is the number of not visited elements in the moment when we invoke the DFS procedure for vertex V. So here should be times log LV, because LV is size of our list, but we can say that for each vertex it is at more at most log n. That's why I kept log n here. So the total complexity of our algorithm is the sum of these complexities of invocation of DFS for each vertex. That is this one. Log n non depends on V, that's why it is outside of our sum, but this sum using Cauchy-Schwarz-Bunyakovsky inequality, we can say that the sum of square root of product, it is product of square root of sums. Yeah, and we know that sum of sizes of neighbor lists is adjacency list is just number of edges, because each edge gives us two elements in two lists. So in fact, it is 2m in the case of undirected graph, and in case of direct graph, it is just m. So, but what about number of not visited elements? We know that each element marked as a visited only once each node or each vertex. So it means that, and after that, it doesn't include it to any other list of not visited vertex. So that's why we can say that some of these numbers is just number of vertexes. So the and total complexity is square root of n m log n. You know that m is between n and n square. It means that if m is enough big, so bigger than n log n, then we get quantum speed up here. And also, if we consider adjacency matrix as a way for storing a graph, then we obtain the biggest gap between quantum and classical complexity, that is n to the 1.5. And the same gap we have if we consider full graph, or at most full graph. So, let's continue with the BFS algorithm. It is, we can consider the similar graph and vertexes and M edges, and the similar way of storing it is adjacency one matrix, adjacency list. And as the next step is adjacency matrix, now it is adjacency list. So let's look to the one of standard ways of representing BFS algorithm. So I have Q data structure. When we start from some vertex, we mark it as visited and add to Q, and then until Q is not empty, we get next vertex V from top of Q and remove it from Q. And then consider all neighbors of this V. If they are not visited, we mark it as visited and add to Q. So here the similar situation like in DFS algorithm, and we replace it by consider not visited neighbors of V, and we can replace it by quantum algorithm that returns all marked elements from this list neighbors V, when where not marked means not visited. Okay, so here zero, or we can say here false. It's the same. So because we consider the similar way, we replace in the similar way the some classical part by quantum part, the complexity is the same. It is the complexity of considering all vertexes, and to consider one vertex is just iterating by all not visited vertexes and not visited neighbors of the vertex. It means that complexity is the same. So let's continue with some specific problem that based on dynamic programming approach for DAGs. Let me remind you, DAG is directed a cycling graph. That means that we don't have cycles and each stage is directed. So now let's look to one game on this DAG. We have n vertex and n edges. We have game where two players play this game on some fixed vertex A, the starting vertex. We put a stone, and players one by one in their turn move stone, and they can move stone from one vertex to another. Let's draw an example. For example, we have some graph like this. And for example, here we have a stone, and player to player, for example, Alice and Bob play game, and Alice in their turn can move in her turn can move the stone to this node, or this node, one of these vertices. For example, she move it to this node, and then Bob on their turn can move to one of neighbor nodes of this vertex, neighbor vertex of this vertex. That's half on the one, and they, on their turn he move it to for example this vertex. Okay, and here. And if some player here, Alice, cannot move stone, then this player loses. So here, Alice loses because she cannot move stone from this this node. So the question is to know if we start from some vertex A, who wins, first player or second player. So it is one of standard problems on in game theory, game on graphs, And what we can do, we can consider all vertexes from 0 to n. So if we we expect that they are topologically sorted, and for each vertex, vertex I, what we do, we when we consider it, if we look to all neighbor elements of X, neighbor, I mean the vertex that can be reached from by one edge from I, if all neighbor elements X such that when X is true, so it can if player if we start from this vertex X and then the first player can win, then if all neighbors such that when X is true, then when I is false. So it means that we cannot win if we start from vertex I. So because if we move to all any of neighbors, then the second player that becomes first player is win, wins. So it means that we cannot win on this from this vertex. But if there is false, then we can move exactly to this vertex, and it means that VI is true. So by it is a solution, classical solution of this problem, and we start when I is for, so we process all vertexes and we check when A, and if when A is true, then first player can win, and if win A is false, then any by using any strategy, the first player cannot win if the second player uses the optimal strategy. Okay. So here we, in fact, we sort any win X false among neighbors of I've vertex, so we can do it using Grover search and using win function and neighbor neighbors I list as a searching space. If Grover search don't find anything, then find when I is false. If it finds something, then when I is true. In fact, here not when, but it should be not when, because we search where when is false. If when is false, then we it's good. We marked when I as true. If where is no when, where is no false element when, then we mark when I as false. Okay, so let's consider the complexity of this algorithm. For vertex V, we go Grover sort, that is log V, so that is square root of number of neighbors, and we need log N for good error probability that can would be very small, much less than constant, and using log n repetition we can reach it. So the total complexity is square root of sum of square root of LV for each V, that is using Cashier-Schwarz-Bunyakovsky inequality, is the similar square root of sum of LV times square root of N, that is, as we discussed on the previous slide, square root of LV is square root of M, number of edges, times number of square root of number of vertexes, that is square root of NM. That's similar. You can see that they have the similar similar complexity because, so in fact, this algorithm somehow based on DFS. Not exactly DFS, but somehow they have the similar idea. Okay, and in case of adjacency matrix, it is O or 1.5. Yeah, of course, times log n. So the next problem I just explained you, and this problem will be your home task until the next meeting. We'll discuss it on the in the beginning of next meeting. So the problem is the following. We have D and G of n vertices and edges and have one fixed vertex, and we want to find the longest path, simple path. It means that no vertex can be repeated in this path twice. We cannot repeat the same vertex. So we haven't cycles here. It means that anyway, they cannot repeat them. So we want to find the longest path in this graph that starts from A. You know that this problem, if it is not DNG, but it is general graph, it is, in that case, it is NP-hard problem. But in the case of DNG, it is easy problem. It can be solved using dynamic programming approach. So please try to do it and apply a similar idea and apply quantum subroutines to obtain some better complexity comparing to the classical one. Okay, that's all for today's meeting. Let's meet next time. Thank you, goodbye.